breast cancer. Approximately 1 in 8 American women will develop breast cancer during their lifetime. Breast cancer is the second most commonly diagnosed form of cancer in women. Sobering statistics, which really underscore the efforts to manage, care for, and ultimately beat this disease. With us today, Dr. Nancy Peacock, a medical oncologist specializing in breast cancer treatment with Tennessee Oncology and chair of the St. Thomas Health Network Cancer Committee. And coming up a little later on this morning, a breast cancer survivor will share her incredible story. But first, we want to welcome Dr. Peacock to the show. Good morning to you, doctor.
Good morning, Danielle.
In the fight against breast cancer, have we seen quantifiable improvement, would you say, over the last, let's say, 10 years or so?
Yes, I think women are much more aware about the need for mammography and seeking that out from their healthcare providers in a proactive way. I think we've made quantifiable improvements in our approaches to surgical treatment, to radiation treatment, and actually our ability to predict who's going to respond best to systemic chemotherapy or biologic therapy or hormonal therapy. And finally, I think we're able to better identify women who have genetic mutations or a familial risk for breast cancer.
From a breast cancer patient perspective, what are some of the biggest challenges?
Acute toxicities from chemotherapy, such as hair loss, nausea and vomiting, oral mucositis, fatigue, neuropathy, which is numbness of the fingers and toes, radiation dermatitis. I think that hormonal therapy also causes toxicity. This is hormone blocking agents that prevent estrogen from causing breast cancer cells to grow and develop. Anytime you deprive a woman of estrogen, you make her feel a little more tired. She has hot flashes, what we call vasomotor symptoms, hot flashes, night sweats, joint aches, irritability, insomnia. Most women kind of go through that gradually after the age of 50, but young women who have estrogen positive breast cancers are forced into that early because of their treatment.
So for patients who are estrogen receptor positive, can you explain the significance for those who are undergoing treatment?
About 75% of women with breast cancer will have either the presence of the estrogen receptor, the progesterone receptor, or both of them. What that means to the physician is that we can use hormone blocking agents such as tamoxifen or the aromatase inhibitors as a real strategy to reduce the risk of those breast cancers from coming back. Initially, we just thought that we needed to use them for 5 years, but there's more and more evidence emerging that carrying these hormonal blockers out for 10 years of therapy as opposed to 5 is probably going to be a strategy that reduces late risk of relapse even more.
In your opinion, what would you say is the biggest reason that women fall short in maintaining their therapy regimen?
First of all, they're dealing with the side effects of their treatments. The chemotherapy that we've already talked about, they're going through toxicities of hormonal therapy. Again, joint pain, weight gain, hot flashes, not sleeping well at night. And you mix that in with life issues such as child rearing, issues with their relationship with their spouse. These women may be concerned about their jobs and keeping their insurance coverage. All of those things will have to have one bad guy as the culprit, as the thing that's causing the side effects and the life issues. And I think that the thing that most commonly is picked out as the bad guy is the hormone blocking agent, because before they had it, they didn't have all these problems. Mm-hmm. But I think there are real ways that we can deal with toxicities. We have pretty good pharmaceutical interventions that we can use to help with specific side effects and problems. And so a woman just really needs to talk to her healthcare provider.
Well, I want you to stick around because we're going to meet a breast cancer survivor here to share her journey and her road to recovery. We'll be right back. Welcome back to our segment on breast cancer and therapies associated with this disease. With us once again, Dr. Nancy Peacock, medical oncologist specializing in breast cancer treatment, and joining us, breast cancer survivor Julie McGee. Julie, welcome to the couch. Glad to have you with us this
morning. Thanks for having me.
Doctor, before we hear from Julie, I want to probe a bit further in terms of the options that women who fall short in their therapy regimen, such as tamoxifen, what's being done to help ensure that they do continue as prescribed?
There are options for people besides pills. There is a liquid form of tamoxifen that's available. There are ways to treat hot flashes and night sweats with pharmaceuticals. There are ways to take care of irritating mouth ulcers with a drug called Gelclair. We have ways to help prevent and treat radiation dermatitis with another product called Bionect. So there are lots of support options out there. We just need to make sure we're asking the questions to the patient to find out what they need.
Julie, how did you first discover you had breast cancer?
Danielle, I was doing a routine breast exam and found a lump that I had never felt before, and immediately called my doctor, and he set up an appointment for a mammogram, which was followed by a biopsy. And I waited a good week and a half, and I heard the words that nobody wants to hear. You have breast cancer. It was very hard, really hard. I had a lumpectomy, and following that, I had radiation treatment. I was then put on Tamoxifen by my oncologist, which is a tablet form, and I can't take pills, never have been able to. And so he gave me an alternative called Soltamox, which it's the exact same drug as Tamoxifen. It works the exact same for reducing my risk, and I've been taking it for a while now and have had no side effects from it.
And the great thing about that is that's a liquid form. Dr. Peacock, is Julie's story fairly typical, and are there other kind of supportive care issues that cancer patients should be aware of?
The importance of her story is that she recognized there was something different. She paid attention to it and she got help for it. A lot of women will tend to blow that off or not pay attention, just say, oh, it's nothing, and go on with their day.
Especially if you're younger.
Especially if you're younger. She has a hard time taking tablets, and so she had a liquid form of the same medication available. So many of my patients will come in and tell me, I just can't take another pill. I cannot take pills. Don't you have anything else for me? And I think it's really important for the medical people to say, are you taking your pills? And if not, why?
One thing people have to do is educate themselves about their breast cancer treatments. Breastcancer.org is a great website. It's so informative, and I definitely believe that knowledge is power.
You know, I was just thinking here, you know, certainly you doing your self-breast exam may have saved your life. And I wanted to pose that last question to you, Doctor. What are some closing thoughts?
I think the great news is that survival is improving with breast cancer. I think it's also important that people know that there are supportive care options out there. It's not all about what's the best treatment option. It's about how do we support people through their treatments. People need to be aware that there are options out there for them.
Thank you so much, Julie. I'm so glad you're here to tell your story. And Doctor, I have to tell you, terrific information. Thank you for joining us as well this morning. And if you'd like to get more information on today's topic, just go to the web at breastcancer.org or visit thebalancingact.com and share your thoughts and concerns related to breast cancer with us. You can also log on to Facebook and search for Balancing Act Fans.